volcanic rock, you have sedimentary rock, and it could be many different things. So you have basalt, that's what we use to protect the coastline of Holland. Everybody knows marble. We often use it either for tiles or for tables and that kind of stuff. So those are types of rock. You could also say stone, but usually with stone we already talk about pieces of stone that we use for building purposes, and rock is what we call the intact material. In dredging we use cutter heads to cut rock, and that's not exceptional. We often do that, and we go to rocks of about 60 MPa. And I noticed some people didn't follow the introduction dredging course, where I already looked into the soil mechanics, and not everybody had soil mechanics. So if you want to know a little bit more about the material properties and the behavior, you should download the soil mechanics lecture notes, which I put in under week one. Yeah, so there you can find, and that's just for information, to give you a feeling, what are we talking about? What kind of values do you have if you talk about compressive strength? What is it, and how big is it? What are we talking about? So those numbers you can find in those lecture notes. You could also go to some courses of petroleum engineering where they have specific courses about that, where they give a lot of information. But yeah, that means you have to look through complete lecture notes of a whole course, and that could be a little bit too much. Well, those are two types of cutter heads. So you see the cutter head, you see the teeth on the cutter head, and in this picture I show a lot of different types of pick points. We call them pick points, and the pick points are in fact the tools that cut the rock, and those pick points are normally mounted on an adapter. You put a steel bar through it to fix it, and that means when it's broken or when you have too much wear, you can take it off and replace it. And on some projects this happens every hour, so after 1 hour the whole cutter head is either too much damaged or all the pick points are worn out and you have to replace all the pick points. So that could be very expensive, but for a dredging company, if you know this is the kind of job you do, then in the offer you make, you calculate how many pick points do we expect to use, and that's part of the deal you make. So for those people in the companies, it's very important. They have some idea about the forces, the power, but also the wear that may occur. In fact, right now we have one student who will investigate this for Boskalis. We know something about wear, but we don't have good models where you can actually predict the wear. There is something, but not good enough. This student has to model the whole three-dimensional movements of each pick point, determine how much rock it is cutting, determine the forces in 3D. Then once you know the forces on each pick point, with some models you could try to determine the wear of each pick point. In fact, you could say the wear for a specific type of rock, the wear depends on how much cutting energy you use. So if you know the specific energy of the type of rock and you know the volume that has been cut by that pick point, that would give you a good indication of the wear of that pick point. Now the problem is that if a pick point like this is worn out, it means usually the top is worn out. So if you are cutting like this, the bottom has a lot of wear. That means you will also get a force at the bottom, a force which we normally don't have. And this force takes care that the swing wires of the cutter dredge, the cutter dredge is dredging like this, with at the top the cutter head. Here you have a wire, we call it the swing wire, and that swing wire has to pull. But if there's too much wear on those pick points, you get a force in this direction on the teeth, and the swing force has to become too big. And usually when they reach the limit of the swing wire, as the swing wire can generate a certain power and a certain torque, well, when you are at the limit of what the swing wire can do, usually they will say the cutter head is worn too much, because if you are at the limit of that swing wire, you have to reduce speed. Your production goes down. And yeah, if I don't have maximum production, I'm losing money. And then replacing the cutter head is cheaper than continuing too long with a worn cutter head, because your production is really decreasing rapidly. So they would like to know that. Okay, this gives you an impression of what those things look like, and it's also a picture that I used in the lecture notes. When you are cutting rock, we have to distinguish between brittle cutting and ductile cutting. Brittle looks like this, so if I measure the force as a function of time, I get an irregular sort of sawtooth. So I have big peaks and I have smaller peaks, and that has to do with big pieces of rock that collapse and smaller pieces that collapse. So it's not just one piece that breaks out. It could first be a number of smaller pieces and then one big piece. And that's why you have all those peaks and finally a big peak. What does it look like? Well, brittle looks like this. So really pieces of material break out, and that process of breaking out could be because of tensile failure when you exceed the tensile stress, but it could also be shear failure. So in contrary with clay, in clay if you have shear failure it's plastic failure, which means the clay stays intact. But if you are cutting rock and you have shear failure, you get a discrete shear plane and the material collapses and a piece of rock will break out. A chip is just a piece of material that breaks out. We call it a chip. Here you see ductile cutting. So you are cutting and you get a nice continuous material. So that's what you would have when you are cutting steel or cutting clay. Now, what we will see in this lecture is that under atmospheric conditions, rock fails like this in general. So brittle, so we get chips, discrete chips. But under very high pressures, we call it hyperbaric cutting, usually rock fails like this. We are still thinking about a new word for what happens under hyperbaric conditions, because if you really talk about ductile cutting, it means plastic deformation, the material stays intact. Yeah, so after the cutting you still have that type of material. But if I'm hyperbaric cutting, it looks like this, but as soon as I take away the pressure, I have powder. So just imagine you are cutting a normal brick that you use for building houses, and you would cut it under very high pressure, then the bindings between the particles collapse, but because of huge underpressures, it stays together, it sticks together. So in the beginning, when you observe it through a window, you think, oh, it's a nice ductile cutting process. But if I take away that pressure, then what's left is powder, because I made all the bindings between the particles collapse. So it's just powder. So in fact, it looks like ductile, but it's not. And there is not yet a good word for that, so I challenged my PhDs to come up with some new term for this type of cutting process. What does it look like if you do measurements? Here you have the strain. Epsilon is the strain, so it's the amount of volume deformation. Sigma is the pressure. And then you can see if you are cutting brittle, you have a buildup of stresses up to a certain maximum stress, which we call the strength of the material. So that would be the shear strength of the material. Then the material collapses, and after the collapse, the stresses go down very rapidly. In some materials, they will go down to zero. Yeah, if you really have a chip breaking out, then after that, there is no stress anymore. So it would go down to zero. But that depends on the process. It doesn't have to go all the way to zero. If you have ductile, then in fact you get a sort of asymptotic behavior where the stresses increase, and here they start increasing more slowly, but at the end they will stay at a certain level. Yeah? So there is a maximum level, and not like in this picture where it continues to increase. There is a maximum level to that stress, and that's also what we call the shear strength of such a material. You have materials in between, and then you also get a curve in between, which we call brittle ductile, so it's a sort of transition. Well, what happens really, and in fact, what really happens is something we don't have an equation for that yet. So the equations I will show you are simplified models which give a good indication of the cutting forces, but for this real process we don't have an equation or a model. Yeah, a model does not always mean you have one equation. It could be a whole algorithm or whatever, but it doesn't exist yet. So what happens here? This is the pick point, and you can see here this is the wear flat. So this is a worn pick point, and we study that because in reality all pick points are worn after they are used for 10 minutes. So what happens? Well, in front of this pick point, so here you have the layer you are cutting. In front of the pick point here, you have an area with very high normal stresses. Those stresses are so high that the bindings between the particles collapse. So you get particles. Yeah, it's not a material with strength anymore. It's like sand. So that's what happens over here. We call it the crushed zone. So the material is crushed. It doesn't exist anymore as the original material. So this is the crushed zone. Then this crushed zone will have a certain normal stress in or stress distribution, if you want. So it's pushing in every direction to the outside of the crushed zone. That will take care that you get stresses, shear stresses and normal stresses, in the intact rock. Normally, that will result in some shear plane here. So the material wants to start shearing over there. It says shear plane number 2. But once it starts shearing, you get a bending moment on the chip. And the bending moment will take care that in this area you get a so-called tensile crack. Yeah, it will break because of tensile failure. Well, that means in this process you have, well, in fact you have, you could say you have four areas, but this is the crushed zone, this is the area with high normal stresses, the shear plane zone, and the tensile crack zone. So you have four areas. And each area has a different behavior. So if we look in this graph basically, it's the PQ graph, which is derived from the tau sigma graph, so from the Mohr circle graph, but you could also draw this picture in a Mohr circle graph. Basically, what you have here, you have the tensile strength. So, in this area with a tensile crack, you are in this area. Yeah, that's where you get tensile cracks. So that's the tensile area. The shear plane is this area, because you have to exceed the shear strength of the material, the failure condition. Then area number three, here in front of the crushed zone, is at the top of this curve. And area number four, the crushed zone, is at the end of the curve. So basically, in one cutting process, you have all regions of the whole curve. In fact, if we would draw the curve in the normal Mohr-Coulomb graph with the tau and the sigma, it would look almost the same. Yeah. So you have four different areas and different types of failure that may occur at the same time. And that makes it difficult to have one model for this, one theory for this. So I didn't find a theory where you can actually calculate forces based on this model. So then what to do? Well, you have to simplify the model and see, okay, maybe under certain conditions I can apply another theory. And the first theory I want to discuss is the so-called Evans theory. What did Mr. Evans do? Mr. Evans said, if we take a cone, a 2D cone with a certain top angle alpha, or in fact it's 2 alpha, and you push against a piece of rock, and in fact they often use this theory in rock cutting when you are drilling tunnels in Switzerland, or when you are drilling coal, that kind of material. They often use this because they have this kind of a tool, and they push or they hammer against the rock and they want it to collapse. So what did Mr. Evans say? He said, suppose here you have a piece of a circle, and at that whole circle we will have tensile failure. So the material will fail because of tensile. So if you push hard enough, you split the rock. In fact, that's the idea behind this theory. Okay, so how big is this circle? Well, from the tip of the pick point, you can make a vertical line. Then you can define an angle beta. And the top, the origin of the circle, depends on the angle beta. If I make my angle beta different, I will get a different origin of that circle. So what you do is you just define this picture. You can determine the total force, because everywhere perpendicular on that circle you have your tensile stress. So you can integrate that, and then you find an equation for the total force. And that total force is this T. Then you can say, okay, what will nature do? Nature will make it collapse where the T is the smallest. Yeah, at the smallest force where it could collapse, it will collapse. So I can take the derivative of that T with respect to beta and determine for which beta do I have the smallest force. And then I will say, okay, that will be the beta where the material will collapse. By the way, the picture is in the lecture notes with the complete derivation of those forces. So you will also find it there. Well, so what do we have? We found a beta based on minimum energy. Yeah, we call it the minimum energy principle. And then if you know this T, you can also determine the forces required. In both directions you have a force R, the forces on the pick point required to generate this force T, because they have to be in equilibrium. The nice thing about this model is that you have the force R on both sides of the pick point, because in fact the pick point is splitting the material, so both sides of the pick point have to push against the material to make it fail. Yeah, so that's the Evans model. I will show you the resulting equation after this. Here we have the HI again, so the HI is always the thickness of the layer we are cutting, and so on. And here you have the delta, which was the external friction angle. Yeah, so that's if we look at the equations, the equation you find is not too complicated. This is the cutting force, this is the horizontal cutting force, and this is the vertical cutting force. And in this case, because the pick point is horizontally pressing against the rock, in this case the vertical force is zero, because in both directions you have that R force and they compensate in the vertical direction. So you don't have a vertical force in this model. Here you can see the cutting force is the tensile strength. So if I know my tensile strength, I can determine the force. This is the layer thickness, the width of the pick point, and here you have a relation where the alpha was half the top angle of the pick point and delta is the external friction angle. You can see that the internal friction angle does not play a role, which makes sense because it's failing on tensile, not on shear. If I would have failure on shear, I need my internal shear angle, but it's failing on tensile, but still I have the forces on my pick point and there I have my external friction angle. So that's why the external friction angle plays a role, but the internal does not. If you divide it like here with the production, then this is the specific energy in this case. So if you know the alpha and the delta of your the alpha of your pick point and the delta of your rock, you can say the specific energy is a constant times the tensile strength. And in literature you can find values for that constant from practice, but you can also use this theory to calculate the constant. Now you can imagine if you are dredging with such a cutter head with those 3D pick points, then a pick point will never push against the rock horizontally. It will have a certain angle. So if I just rotate the whole picture, and that's what I'm doing here, I'm rotating this over an angle epsilon, so the original picture from the previous slide is this white rectangle. Yeah, so I just rotated the whole picture, but I have to compensate for that epsilon with the number of angles, because now if you look vertically, this R and this R are not compensating anymore completely in the vertical direction, because I rotated the picture. Yeah, so I'm just rotating the previous picture and take the correct sines and cosines for the forces, and then I get this. So what do we have? Here we have the total cutting force. The cutting force is in the direction of the pick point, not yet in horizontal direction. Yeah, so it's in the direction of the pick point, through the axis of the pick point. Well, the beginning is the same. Oh, I see I miss an I here. So you have the tensile strength again, the layer thickness, the width of the blade, And now you see that in this sign, an epsilon is added. For the rest, the equation is the same as the previous equation. But to determine horizontal and vertical force, yeah, for horizontal I have to take the cosine of that epsilon, and for the vertical force I have to take the sine, because the direction is not horizontal anymore, of this Fc. And then also for the specific energy, because specific energy is always based on the horizontal force, because the velocity is in the horizontal direction. So here you also get that cosine that you had here to determine your specific energy. Now what is interesting is, could we also simulate a real pick point with a weir flat at the bottom with this method? Well, we can. Yeah. Because this angle epsilon, we just make that angle epsilon equal to half the top angle of the pick point. So here you have your alpha, which was 2 times alpha was the top angle of the pick point. If we make the epsilon exactly equal to alpha, then the bottom of the pick point becomes horizontal. And then we can say, okay, so now we have a pick point with a horizontal bottom, and that horizontal bottom, in fact, is the weir of the pick point. So we just rotate over half the top angle of the pick point, and that way we can simulate a pick point with weir. And that's nice, because also in that study of the student who just started with weir, the question is, but how do we know the vertical force on the bottom of the pick point? Well, with this theory, it follows from the theory. So you know the force here. Yeah, in fact, it's this r times a certain cosine. And then if you know the normal force, you can also calculate the friction force, because you know the friction angle, the external friction angle. Yeah, so it's just a matter of rotating the original model over the right angle, and you can simulate pick points with weir. Well, what kind of equation do you get? Since we rotate it with an epsilon that is equal to alpha, that's what we did. So the epsilon can be deleted or can be replaced in the equation, and you can see that because of that here we get a 2 alpha. For the rest, the equation is the same. Well, we have to multiply with cosine alpha and sine alpha to get the horizontal and the vertical component, and if you use this horizontal force in the specific energy equation, you get this equation for the specific energy. And it's, again, it's linear, it's proportional to the tensile strength. This is a nice model, but it only works if you have tensile failure. If I don't have tensile failure, if I already know I will not get tensile failure, for example, because my tensile strength is too high, that could be the case, yeah, then I cannot use this model because it doesn't apply. Well, if I do not have tensile failure, and later I will show you a graph, and with that graph you can determine whether you will have tensile failure or brittle failure. If I don't have tensile failure, then what do I have? Well, the only other option is shear failure. Yeah, it's either shearing or it's breaking by tensile. There's another model made by a person called Nishimatsu, a Japanese, and those models are already pretty old, but in literature we didn't really find better models. So Mr. Nishimatsu made a model, and it looks very much like the clay cutting model, where he said, okay, I have a pick point, I have a shear plane. On that shear plane I calculate a normal stress and a shear stress. And if I take the equilibrium of forces, horizontal and vertical, I can determine my forces. But Mr. Nishimatsu added something. He said the shear stress in this shear plane does not have to be the same everywhere. Because what could happen is that near the tip of the blade I have a very high shear stress, so the material will start to fail there. But once it starts failing, the next piece of material will also fail, because where it has failed, you don't have strength anymore. So then the remaining part of the rock has to take care of the forces. So he suggested to use a certain distribution over the length of the shear plane. And that distribution, he used a factor n for that distribution. And here you can see this is the tip of the blade. This is the free surface. If I take an n of 0 everywhere, my shear stress is 1, is the maximum shear stress. But if I use an n with another value, for example, I use, let's say, the 1, which is the center one, then you get a linear distribution of your stress over the shear plane. I can also use an n that is bigger, for example, the 8, which gives me the lowest line, and you can see you have a shear stress like this. Then he integrated the stress distribution, and the result is that in your forces you get a factor 1 divided by n plus 1. So if you would use this method, and you have, for example, an n equal to 1, a linear stress distribution, you would get 1 divided by 2 in front of the equation.
What is meant with the distribution?
Distribution? Yeah. Oh, so if you are pushing with a pick point against the rock, then it makes sense that just in front of the pick point you have your maximum normal stress and shear stress. But maybe at the point where it reaches the surface, the stress is still 0. So you get a certain distribution of stress from the tip of the pick point to the surface. Yeah? In the clay cutting, we acted like everywhere in the shear plane, the shear stress was the same, namely the shear strength of the material. But it doesn't have to be like that, because if I would have maximum shear stress at the point at the tip of the blade, and still 0 at the surface, what will happen if I continue pushing my pick point? The material will start to fail near the tip of the blade. Yeah, because material can have a shear crack, just like a tensile crack, it can also have a shear crack. Well, if that shear crack starts occurring near the tip of the blade, then that part of the shear plane cannot resist forces anymore, because it already cracked. So that means at the end of that crack you get a very high stress concentration resulting in the crack to move forward. Can you imagine? Okay. So, and that's, so you start with a certain stress distribution, yeah? For example, this one, the lowest one, it means you have a high stress near the tip of the blade, but near the surface the stress is still 0.
How do you know which end to take?
You can only know if you do experiments with that material and see if you can measure those stresses. That's the only way to do it. In fact, what Mr. Nishimatsu did, he created this theory, and then from experiment, he is not measuring the stresses, he is just saying, okay, so if I measure a force, because forces can be measured, and the force would be like 50% of what would be expected based on this part of the equation, he would say, oh, then n has to be 1. You understand? So he put a very nice theory behind it with the whole stress distribution, but at the end, nobody cares about this picture anymore. Everybody only cares about this one, this term, because with that term you can always have a correction that to make it match. And then you say, oh, my n was 1 or 2 or 3. So that's the way it works in reality. Some coefficients. Here I made some graphs, they are also in the lecture notes, of the coefficients. So with the coefficients I mean this whole term, and here it's called lambda hf and lambda vf, h for horizontal, v for vertical, and the f is for the flow type, because basically he is also working with shear failure, so that's the flow type. Here you can see what those coefficients look like based on here the blade angle and here the angle of internal friction. So you can see that if you have a very, if you don't have internal friction, but in rock you always have some internal friction, you would have the lowest line. And if you have a very high internal friction, 45, which is too high for normal rock, rock normally would be 20-25 degrees. So you are in the middle, and then from this graph you can actually read which coefficient you have to use in the previous equations. So this one is for the horizontal force and this one is for the vertical force. Well, then we go to the theory that I want to show you, because the previous are some theories from literature, and with the model you already had for sand and clay and so on, you can also solve this problem. In fact, the result is almost the same as Nishimatsu, except for that n factor, because I don't believe in that n factor. Because if you don't really measure the stress distribution, but you just use an n to make it match, that's not really what I want. I want a controllable theory. So the definitions are the same as with sand and clay. Which forces do we have? Well, if you cut rock under atmospheric conditions, then we have the C. I still call it cohesion, but with rock everybody would say shear strength. In clay they often use the word cohesion, but in rock or in steel we don't use the word cohesion, we say shear strength. Or maybe the UCS, the unconfined compressive strength. Or so the C, that's the shear force based on the shear strength, because you are shearing the material. Later I will show you what happens for tensile failure, but this is for shear failure. Okay, that will result in a normal force and a shear force on the shear plane under an angle phi, so under the angle of internal friction. And then on the blade we only have this normal force and the shear force, because we assume rock does not have adhesion, it's not sticky. Normally if you put your hand on rock, your hand will not stick to the rock, so it doesn't have adhesion. So those are the forces on this layer that we are cutting. So in fact we start with a model where we act like it fails like clay. And then later we will see where we can use it and where we can't use it. On the blade, so you only have that normal force and that shear force. We also have the moments, but for atmospheric rock we will not use them. But for the moments you only have those two normal forces, because all the other forces go through the tip of the blade, so they are not resulting in a moment. Only the normal forces are resulting in a moment. For, like I said, for atmospheric rock we don't need the moment equation. What is the resulting equation? And if you would write the C as a force based on the stress, you would see it's the same equation as Mr. Nishimatsu, apart from that n factor. So this is the resulting K2, and then you put them in the horizontal and vertical force equations, and this is what you find. Yeah. So the big difference with Mr. Evans is that here you also have the internal friction in the equation, and you don't have the tensile strength. Yeah, Evans is completely based on tensile strength. This equation is based on shear failure. So you have the shear strength in your equation. What does it look like if you make more circle of that process? So you can take the stresses on the shear plane and on the blade and construct a more circle. Well, if you do that, then the top of the circle should touch the failure line. This is the failure line under an angle phi, and so that's the phi of your rock. Here you have the so-called UCS value. Why? Because I made a circle that on this side goes through the origin. If it goes through the origin, then this maximum stress here is what we call the UCS value. You can determine that with a triaxial test on a sample of rock, and then you will find this circle. But you need a couple of circles to determine the phi. Yeah, from one circle you can never determine the phi, because in this case the failure line is not going through the origin. So you need at least 2 points to find the failure line, and this failure line. Here you have the tensile strength. You could determine the tensile strength, for example, with the BTS test, the Brazilian tensile strength test, and that way you get your tensile strength. Like I told you yesterday, I think, if you know the tensile strength here and the UCS, you can construct the failure lines, but it doesn't have to be so rectangular like here. It could be a smooth curve, but in fact we are not really interested in that. All we are interested in is what is the tensile strength and where is this failure line. That's what we are interested in. Okay, we will stop for a break. Continue in 15 minutes. We're busy with the Mohr circle of rock cutting. This is the Mohr circle of a UCS test. And yesterday I already showed you the Mohr circle in the case of tensile failure. And tensile failure could occur like this. In fact, it's not exactly the same tensile failure that you saw in the first picture, explaining the whole process of rock cutting, but it's a model, and the model gets close to measurements from reality, and I will show you some of those measurements later. Well, this is the situation that you get when you have tensile failure. So you determine your Mohr circle, and in fact once you know the forces on the shear plane and the forces on the blade, you can determine the total Mohr circle in the rock. And if it would be a Mohr circle like this, then you can see here you exceed the tensile strength, because the tensile strength is at this point. Well, you can do many things to say, okay, how can I calculate the forces in such a case? What I do is reduce the Mohr circle, just make the radius of the Mohr circle smaller in such a way that this point just touches the tensile strength. In the lecture notes you can find a whole derivation of how I do that, but I'm just reducing, in fact I'm reducing the shear strength of the material in such a way that you get a circle just touching the tensile strength. If you get such a circle, you can see it touches the tensile strength here, but the top does not touch the shear strength anymore. So this is a circle where you get tensile failure, but you don't have shear failure. If you want shear failure, the whole big circle should move to the right in such a way that it doesn't touch the tensile strength anymore. That's very simple. If somewhere the circle exceeds a failure criterion, then that's where it will fail. And in this case, it exceeds the tensile strength, so you get tensile failure. This is a picture, a graph. I still have to change the graph. One of my PhDs gave me some tip. He said, this looks like 1,000 and this looks like 10,000. But the dot is the decimal dot, so this is just 1 and this is just 10. So why not just leave all the zeros away? And I will do that in the next issue. So I will change the graphs to make them a little bit more clear. In fact, if you are below a line, it means you have either ductile or shear failure. If you are above a line, you have brittle failure based on tensile failure. And here, vertically, you see the UCF, which is the compressive strength of the material, divided by the BTS, which is the tensile strength of the material. So compressive strength divided by tensile strength. If you get a very high value for this ratio, it either means the compressive strength is very high or the tensile strength is very low. But in both cases, it means the ratio, so the tensile strength is very small compared to the compressive strength. In that case, it's easy to get brittle failure. So here you can see above lines, those are the lines for different angles of internal friction. Above a line, I could have tensile failure. Below a line, I cannot. I put two lines in here. This line is a line they often use in dredging. It's a ratio value of 9, and in dredging they say, if the ratio UCS-BTS is below 9, we will not have brittle failure, we will have ductile failure. And above this line, they say we will have brittle failure. And in between, you have a certain transition ratio, transition region. Now, let's look at real values for rock. A real value for the internal friction angle would be 20 degrees, something near 20 degrees. Here we have the 20 degrees, which is this curve. Now, if you look at that curve, you see it crosses the 9 at a blade angle of 50-55 degrees. That's the normal angle of pick points in dredging. So apparently, if I use a cutter head, 50-55 degrees blade angle, and I look at a real rock of 20 degree internal friction angle, I'm exactly at this factor 9 that they use in dredging. Yeah, so this graph gives you a feeling, could I have tensile failure or not? What you can also see is if I go to very high, large blade angles, it's more difficult to get tensile failure, and the reason for that is if I have a 110 degree blade, I get so much compressive stress in front of the blade, I will never have tensile stresses anymore. Yeah, so very high or big blade angles will not result in tensile failure. Yeah? I will, in oil drilling you do, you use 110. And that means in oil drilling, when I use those Stratapax, the diamond blades, the small blades, I will never have tensile failure. Yeah, it doesn't mean it cannot be brittle, because brittle can also be a brittle shear failure. If I get a discrete shear plane, that's also brittle. Yeah, brittle just means pieces of material break out. That's what brittle means. So I have two types of brittle, tensile brittle and shear brittle. Yeah, both can be brittle. Next picture, in fact, shows a little bit the same. Here you have the BTS, the tensile strength divided by the cohesion. And normally the cohesion is about 50% of the compressive strength. Not completely, because we have an internal friction angle. And here I put the BTS negative, because tensile strength is negative. And again, also in this picture, it means if you are below the line, you have what we call ductile or shear. If you are above a line, you have brittle failure. So you can use one of the two graphs. And I'm planning to improve the readability of the graphs a little bit to add some titles. So in the graph, you already can see what exactly does it mean. Here I have the brittle coefficients. So in the equations, you have coefficients. And you can see, in fact, with the vertical coefficient, it stops here. And that means beyond that point, you cannot have tensile failure. Yeah, those are graphs for tensile failure. But if it can't exist, that's where the line stops. Just read it in the lecture notes for some more explanation. Then we go to hyperbaric rock cutting, and that's what that CEO of IHC was talking about. First of all, when we are cutting rock, and this is a specific energy graph, in literature you can find some data, not much, but you can find some data of people who did experiments, cutting experiments on different types of rock. This is a sort of marble. And if you analyze those measurements, what do you see? If I don't have this, by the way, this pressure is the hydrostatic pressure of the water. And this is in MPa. 100 kPa is 10 meters of water, right? So 1 MPa is 100 meters of water. And that means this 10 is 1,000 meters of water. Yeah, so that's what it means. Now, what do you see? If I have zero pressure, that also means 0 meters of water, I find specific energies in this region. Now, if I increase my water depth here, so 1 MPa would be 100 meters, I can see it increases rapidly. So apparently the water depth influences the specific energy and also the cutting forces. So they increase with increasing water depth. But at a certain point, those points follow a line with less steepness. It's not as steep as in the beginning. Well, this is brittle here. Is brittle cutting. This is what we call ductile cutting. So you can see that in the first 100 meters of water depth, you get a sort of transition between brittle cutting and ductile cutting, because the water plays a role, and the water plays a role just like in sand cutting, because of pore pressures. You get pore pressures in your rock, and they influence the specific energy. This is the same kind of graph in a limestone, and you can see the same type of behavior. So this is brittle again. It increases rapidly until it becomes ductile, and there it follows this ductile line. I have one more, but this is forces and not energy, but yeah, the principle is the same. Here you see brittle again. And here you can see the ductile behavior, and yeah, somewhere here at about 1 MPa, those two lines would intersect. Well, what is the difference between hyperbaric rock cutting and atmospheric rock cutting? If you have hyperbaric rock cutting, you have to add pore pressures to your equation. So under atmospheric conditions, those pore pressures hardly play a role. They could play a role, but it's neglectable. And how to determine if pore pressures play a role? Very simple. If you know the compressive strength and the tensile strength of your rock, suppose it's 10 MPa, and you have 10 meters of water depth, which could give you a maximum under pressure of 2 bar, which is 200 kPa, then this 200 kPa is very small compared with the 10 MPa. Yeah, it's 2%. So you can say, okay, if it's just 2%, I can neglect it. But if I would go to 1,000 meters, yeah, where I have 100 bar, and 100 bar would be 10 MPa, yeah, then the underpressure is of the same magnitude as the compressive strength of the material, and suddenly those underpressures start playing a role. So it's just about the ratio between the hydrostatic pressure at the location of your cutting device and the compressive strength of the material. That also means that if you have a very high compressive strength, like 100 MPa, you have to go to a much bigger water depth before you get the same influence on your cutting process. So very strong rocks will not have so much influence of the hyperbaric cutting effect. It's especially the weaker rocks that you have to deal with. But if you do deep sea mining, the mining tools, yeah, in dredging we say we can go up to 60 MPa compressive strength with normal cutter heads. So I assume if you put that kind of equipment at the seafloor, 60 MPa would also roughly be the limit. And then you can see what would be the effect. So if I have 3,000 meters of water depth, I get 30 MPa hydrostatic pressure. If I take that limit of 60 MPa, then it's 50% of the compressive strength. So it would influence the cutting process. But later I will show you how it influences. Well, so the difference between atmospheric cutting and hyperbaric cutting is that now we have the W1 here and the W2 here. And I'm not going to explain all the other forces because we already did that many times. Just to make the picture complete, in this case I also added the A, the adhesion, just to get equations that are more generic. But normally we will say we don't have adhesion in rock. Yeah, but in the equations you can find that A. So if you would have a rock with some adhesion, you can take it into account. Well, forces on the blade also, we added the W2, and those are the resulting equations. So I took the generic equation from the beginning again. I just deleted all the terms that are not to be taken into account. And what is left is the W2 term, the W1 term, and the C term. And then you substitute that in the horizontal and vertical equations. Here I deleted, in fact in this equation I deleted the A terms, so I assume no adhesion. But in the lecture notes you also have the adhesion. Yeah, but normally we do not take that into account. Well, I will put this on blackboard so you don't have to copy all the equations. Now we have a problem. We could have two problems. The equations are again based on the flow type. Now the flow type is a nice type for ductile cutting, and we said okay. Under hyperbaric conditions we will often have something that looks like ductile cutting, so we can use those equations very well. But there may still be a case of tensile failure or the curling type. When did we have the curling type? If you cut very thin layers of material. Now in deep sea mining we will not do that. Usually you will have centimeters, maybe 5 centimeter thickness. But in oil drilling, you are more scraping the material, and they work with a layer thickness less than 1 millimeter. I have examples, I will show you 0.15 millimeter and 0.3 millimeter. So it's really very thin, and in that case, you will get the curling type. This type. in offshore drilling, they call it the balling type. So they don't call it curling, but they call it balling. So the fact that the chip is not following the blade, but it starts curling, they call it balling. Yeah, and it often happens when you are oil drilling, so they have to take measures to make the material flow away, because in oil drilling you want the material that has been cut to mix with the fluid so they can transport it out of the hole. Otherwise, if it stays there, it will block the whole hole. To determine how the curling or balling will look like, you need the moment equation. Well, we have the normal force here and the water force, the under pressure force, and here also. So if you have equations for those forces and you know the radius in both cases, you can determine the moment equilibrium. Now the point is, if you get curling or balling, the chip will not follow the whole blade. And just like with clay, you want to know how far will the chip be in touch with the blade. So in fact, you act like you have a shorter blade. You don't have to write this down, but I just wanted to show you the equations. This, in fact, is this moment equilibrium. So you can see the W2, W1 and the C. This is the moment on the blade, on the layer cut, so in the shear plane. And this is the moment on the blade. And what I did is replace the height of the blade with H accent. And H accent would be the height of the blade required to get an equilibrium of moments. Yeah, so that's why I give it that accent. So H accent is always smaller than the real height of the blade. Well, if you write this down, it will have the shape of a second degree function, and you have to determine the roots of that function. So you have an A, B, and C. Here I put the A, B, and C, and you really have to put this in a computer program because it's too much to do by hand. You could put it in an Excel sheet or something. And then this is the solution for your H accent. Yeah, again, all the equations are in the lecture notes, so you can follow it there. So that's how to find that H accent. Well, is it true? That's the question. So we right now we are cooperating with Shell Oil in this research, and a man of Shell, Mr. Zeisling, did research in the 80s up to 100 MPa, and 100 MPa is 1,000 bar. They had a test facility where they could actually do cutting tests up to 1,000 bar, which equals 10,000 meters of water depth. But that's where they go with oil drilling, because oil drilling doesn't stop where you hit the seafloor. You can go 5 to 10 kilometers deeper to find the oil, yeah? And then you get very high hydrostatic pressures. So this Fn, in fact, in our way of thinking, is the horizontal force. And here you can see tests with, this is 0.3 millimeters and this is 0.15 millimeters. And at the time when they did those tests, they were not exactly sure what it depended on, because they said maybe it depends on the already existing pore pressures in the rock, because if you are oil drilling, the rock is at a certain distance under the surface, so inside the rock you already have a certain pore pressure. So they did tests. That's what you see here with unconditioned means 0, 21 MPa, 30 and 35 MPa, but that's the pore pressure they had in the rock samples. But then they found it doesn't depend on those pore pressure, it just depends on the hydrostatic pressure based on the outside pressure. This pressure doesn't really play a role. That was the conclusion of that research. And that's where they stopped. They didn't make any model. So with the equations I just showed you, I checked the measurements of Mr. Zeisling, and you can see, well, it's not exact, and there is some scatter in those measurements, but they get close enough to say, okay, this is a good way of predicting the forces in oil drilling. I must say, so for that, the theory works. But in this verification, I assumed full cavitation in the layer of material you are cutting. So I'm just cutting 0.15 millimeters, and the underpressure is 1,000 bar. Yeah? Because the permeability of the rock is so low, it starts cooking in the pores. It actually happened, and that was also one of the conclusions of Mr. Zeisling. This gives the specific energy, and what was interesting about the specific energy is if you have two layer thicknesses, and the 0.15 and the 0.3 millimeters, do they give the same specific energy? Well, you could maybe still see a difference between the two layer thicknesses. I can't. So we said, okay, so it's proportional with the layer thickness. By the way, here at zero, you can still see it's below the line, and this was tensile failure, so under atmospheric conditions. For the rest, I think it follows the theoretical line pretty well. Yeah, so the blue line, also in the previous slide, I calculated theoretically with the theory I just showed you. Then, what can we do with that? Well, if you have that theory, so both atmospheric and hyperbaric, based on the theory, you can determine specific energy. Oh yeah, I should tell one thing about those measurements. When you are cutting such a thin layer of material, the crushed zone that you saw in the first slide occupies the whole thickness of the layer, because the layer is so thin, so everything is crushed. So it doesn't mean you can use it one-to-one in dredging, because maybe in dredging not everything is crushed.
Then if it's already crushed, why do you still get this span?
Oh, because the underpressure, so you should realize that outside you have a hyperbaric pressure, the hydrostatic pressure of maybe 1,000 bar, but at least hundreds of bars. Between the particles, the pressure is zero. So you get the effect of vacuum-packed coffee. So because of this underpressure, the particles stick together. And it looks, when you do a test, it looks like it's a very nice continuous chip. And that's also what you see with that balling and curling. It's a continuous chip that is curling on the blade. But as soon as they take away the pressure, it falls apart and it's powder. So it sticks together because of the underpressure. This is a graph I made for the specific energy based on the Zeisling experiment, so based on that theory with full cavitation. This is for a 60 degree blade, so this one you could apply in dredging, where you have a cutter head with 55 or 60 degree pick points. So what do you see? First of all, brittle is at the bottom. I have a number of lines here. Those straight lines are for atmospheric cutting, and the black line is ductile cutting under atmospheric conditions. The other lines are if the tensile strength is much less than the compressive strength. In fact, here you can see the ratio, the R, the ratio between the compressive strength and the tensile strength. So if that ratio is high, it means you have a very low tensile strength, and that would give you the lowest curve here. So that's fractured material with very low tensile strength. Now, what happens if we are underwater? And we can start here with 10 bars. That's this one, and 10 bars would be 100 meter of water. You get this red line. So you can see that already 100 meters of water has some influence, but like I said before, especially with a softer rock. So if here you have the compressive strength, so if I have a low compressive strength, already 100 meters of water can increase the specific energy. But if you go to the stronger rocks, so this area is from 10 to 100 MPa, so that's the stronger rock, you can see it hardly influences the black line for ductile cutting. But if I would go to very deep water, here you have 1,000 bar, well, 1,000 bar is 10 kilometers, so that would be very deep, you can see that almost over the whole range, it's almost a horizontal line. And that means everything is determined by the pore pressures and not by the strength of the rock anymore. Yeah, but that would be at 10 kilometers of water depth. Well, and you see lines for all the water depths in between. So from this picture, you can actually get your specific energy, but it's based on completely crushing the material, like in the Seisling experiments. So if you have a situation like in deep sea mining where you use a pick point and chips break out, the specific energy is probably less. Yeah, so this is based on completely crushing the material. But if you know this and you know, okay, here I can find a specific energy which is an upper limit to what will happen in reality, okay, then at least I have an upper limit. Yeah, in reality, if I have bigger chips, the specific energy could be lower, but probably it will never be higher. Yeah, so this is an upper limit to the specific energy. Here you get the graph for rock cutting, 110 degrees. That's those diamond cutting bits. And one of the things you see is that here for atmospheric cutting, you don't see the different lines anymore for tensile fracture because, like I explained, you don't have tensile fracture with a 110 degree bit. You could have, like in sand, wedge forming, could theoretically, but I calculated that the internal friction angle is relatively small, and the shear angle is about 10 degrees, and then you are still far below the 180. Thus, although your blade angle is 110, but if you have an internal friction of, let's say, 20 and an external of 16 and a blade shear angle of 10, you are far enough below the 180 to still use the theory. That's because all the other angles are so small. So this is the chart you can use for drilling, oil drilling, and I checked those values in this range with the experiments of Mr. Seisling. In fact, we wrote a paper together for this summer in Rio de Janeiro at a conference where we published all those graphs. And I must say, in the 80s, I already worked together with Mr. Seisling, and I got my PhD on this research, and he did those experiments, but for some reason, we never communicated about it, so we never combined it to one theory. And then 20 years later, we met again, and then suddenly, did you do that, and you do that? Oh, we can combine it to a theory, and then we also have measurements, experiments to verify the results. This is just a zoom in of the previous graph, so it's easier to read. So although in this region, hyperbaric cutting, we call it ductile, like I explained to you, it's not really ductile because if you take away the pressure, you have powder. and the powder is not ductile. I think this is the... Oh yeah. For deep sea mining, we like to know exactly what is happening. And I already talked a little bit about what the PhDs are doing. Well, this is a picture of one of my PhDs, but this is when he did his master's thesis. What you can see here is a lot of particles. And this is from EDEM. EDEM is Discrete Element Method software. And what you do is you define particles, discrete particles, and you define how those particles are connected. In fact, you could say, okay, the particles do not have any tensile strength, but they have internal friction, sliding friction, rolling friction. But you can also put springs and dampers between all the particles. So each combination of particles, of two particles, has a spring and a damper in between them, in every direction. And this is like a shoebox with 20,000, something like 20,000 of those particles. And then the software will actually calculate the interaction between each set of two particles. And based on that, it will calculate where particles go. So particles, the connection between particles can break, can actually break. I will show you in a video a little later. But in the case of sand, you don't have tensile strength, but you have friction. And in fact, this shows you the cutting of sand. So we simulated sand. And if it has a different color than blue, it means it has velocity. Yeah, so based on velocity, the color of each particle will change. And that way you can see exactly here where you have your shear plane. Well, this shows when the blade has moved forward and the particles fall over the blade. And yeah, you can see exactly what's happening. But this is without under pressure. This is dry sand because we are not yet capable of doing this with pore pressures. And that's the challenge of two of my PhDs. In 4 years' time, they have to implement pore pressures into the method in order to simulate hyperbaric rock cutting. Now, the videos I will show you, it's very short movies. They are made by one of the PhDs. He started beginning of the year. And he said, yeah, those commercial software, EDEM and Itasca and so on, they are too closed, which means if you want to add something, it's difficult. Yeah, it's like you have a finite element program and it doesn't do exactly what you want and you want to change it. Usually that's not possible. So he said, you know what, I'm going to develop everything myself. And he started beginning of the year. And so what you see now is already the result of what he did in one. He did more, but this is part of what he did in the first year. And at the end, we want to be capable that you have a pick point going through the rock and you can see exactly how the rock will fail and what happens. And then if you adjust the hydrostatic pressure, you can, okay, first we do it atmospheric and you can see the chips breaking out. And then we add hydrostatic pressure and you can see how it will change. So we will get some videos. The first video is just to test the software. So here you can see a silo. That's why you thought it's from transportation engineering. But it's not. It's just testing the methodology. So you see all those particles. At a certain point, they open the silo. And just by gravity, all the particles, they are falling out. And you can imagine if you do this on a PC and each time step, so you work with time steps, so like one time step is 1/1000th of a second, and then each time step you have to calculate all the interactions between all the particles. Yeah, and then that's how the software gives you such a result. The second one I will do, yeah, the cutting of sand. So in fact, at the beginning, you see all the, that's what you always do with this software. From the top, you just drop all the particles, they fall. Then when all the particles are at the bottom, you press a button, connect them, yeah, activate the interactions. So otherwise you would think, yeah, in rock, if you just drop the particles, how can it be rock? But that's because once the particles are not moving at the bottom anymore, you turn on all the connections, and from that moment on you can deal with it as real rock. You can also understand that this way, because you just drop the particles, you get a sort of random distribution. And what this guy did is, the size of the particles is different. So you have a distribution of sizes of particles, you drop them, then you get a random distribution at the bottom, and that should match real material better. The next one, this is material. So the previous one was sand without tensile strength between the particles. This is material with tensile strength, and you can see, you can really see those shocks. It's not yet perfect, so if you see something, you say that's not real, it's just a test of the software. But you can see those shocks in the material, and you can see chips breaking out and shooting away. And well, for being busy for 1 year, I think it's already a good job. So this promises something for the next 3 years. He also made some simulations of tests. In fact, the graph you see is the graph of the shear stresses in the material. So this is also cutting of something with tensile strength, and you can see, if you see the green line moving, you can see where pieces break out. Is the recording okay? Good. Then one more, or two more.
Is this last one brittle?
Brittle.
The last one.
Yeah. Then this is the simulation of a UCS test. So in fact, you have a cylinder of material, and there you see the crack. So this is material with a tensile strength and internal friction. And you see the green line approaching that curve, and then at the top you can see you get a crack. And then of course you have to calibrate this with real samples. And you have to do a number of real tests and then see, is my software predicting what happens in reality. So one more, which is also a UCS test. And if it would be the real material, then for example, you could say, oh, it should shear, I should underline like 45 degrees. Well, those are the things he is testing. The biggest problem with this kind of simulations is that normally we work with what we call macro parameters. And what is a macro parameter? Well, you know, internal friction angle. Because how do you measure the internal friction angle? You take a sample of sand or rock or whatever, put it in a triaxial machine, press until it breaks, and based on the Mohr circle, you say, that's my angle of internal friction. In this software, you have to define the interactions between individual particles. We call that the micro parameters. And so if I define a tensile strength between two particles, how is that related to the tensile strength of a block of material? If I determine the sliding friction or the spring stiffness or the damper, how is that related to the bulk? We call it bulk parameters also. Nobody knows. And in the application of this type of software, that's one of the biggest issues, how to connect those bulk parameters to the micro parameters between individual particles. Nobody knows yet. So in fact, from what I know, on internet they are forming a sort of a database of all the people who work with this kind of software. And in the database they explain what kind of experiment they did with the software, and this is the bulk parameter and this is how I modeled the micro parameter. And so you can see you are at the edge of science, because for example, like I told you, the pore pressures are not yet implemented in this type of software. Nobody did that. So if those PhDs do that as the first in the whole world, that means we can do calculations nobody else can do. It also means you can write publications for very good journals because they like this kind of development. Okay, that's it for today. Next week I will do erosion processes. So if you have questions about all the cutting processes, don't wait until the last week. Yeah, if you can already ask questions next week, or please do, because then we still have time enough. Maybe I could make an extra picture or something to explain something. Yeah, but if you have questions, please ask. See you next week.